Hello, and welcome to In the Limelight. My name is John Macero. In the Limelight is a show that gives us the opportunity to showcase those individuals or groups in and around our community who may have an exceptional or unusual story, job, or talent and bring it to our viewers. And today's guests are exceptional. But before we begin, I'd like to introduce you to our in-house musical director, Sarah Byrne Martelli. How you doing, Sarah?
Great, John.
Oh, that's wonderful. For those of you who don't know Sarah, Sarah's a well-known musical director and vocal coach in the Boston area. Sarah, what are some of the shows you've done?
Well, I first met you in 2004, you and Trudy, when we were doing The Music Man.
That's right.
With a large cast. And then I've done a lot of shows with Winthrop Playmakers, A Chorus Line, and Seussical, and taught some summer programs at the Boston Conservatory.
That's wonderful. But you also wear another hat during the day. Do you want to tell our viewers what you do?
Sure. I've always had kind of two careers. So one is the musical theater side, and for the past 20 years, I've worked in hospice and palliative care as a palliative care chaplain. So I work at Mass General during the day, caring for patients with serious illness.
Wow. We're actually going to do a story on you, Sarah, because to be honest, I think you have an amazing story to tell.
Thank you.
So, shall we get started?
Let's do it.
Our first guest is a freshman from Winthrop High School who studies dance, acting, and voice. She loves performing in musicals and is a cheerleader. Jillian Bonapani. Jillian, what are you going to sing for us today?
I'll be singing First Time and Forever from Frozen.
Wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Jillian Bonapani.
Window is open, so's that door. I didn't know they did that anymore. Who knew we owned 8,000 salad plates? For years I've roamed these empty halls. Oh, I have a ballroom with no balls. Finally, they're opening up the gates. There'll be actual real life people. It'll be totally strange. But wow, am I so ready for this change? Cause for the time in forever, there'll be music, there'll be light. For the first time in forever, I'll be dancing through the night. Don't know if I'm elated or gassy, but I'm somewhere in that zone. Cause for the first time in forever, I won't be alone. I can't wait to meet everyone. What if I meet the one? Tonight, imagine me gown and all, fetchingly draped against the wall, the picture of sophisticated grace. I suddenly see him standing there, a beautiful stranger, tall and fair. I want to stuff some chocolate in my face. But then we laugh and talk all evening, which is totally bizarre. Nothing like the life I've led so far. Cause for the first time in forever, there'll be magic, there'll be fun. For the first time in forever, I could be noticed by someone. And I know it is totally crazy to dream I find romance. But for the first time in forever, for the first time in forever, nothing's in my way.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
Welcome back. My first guest is no stranger to our community here in Winthrop. He's a Vietnam vet, a boat builder, an artist, a teacher, and a philanthropist, Richard Honan. Richard, so nice to have you here. Did I miss anything?
No.
You know, I consider you like a true 21st century Renaissance man. What makes you tick, Richard?
Well, I've always been interested in the arts. My mother was a painter. Some of you may remember her. My brothers all took musical instruments, and I was sent off to the Museum of Fine Arts for art lessons. And
How old were you when you were sent off to do that?
I was probably, in the 10, 11, 12.
Really?
You know, when my brothers had taken piano lessons or accordion lessons. And I went, after high school, went off to Vesper George School of Art in Boston, a small art school. And even when I went in the Army trained me to be a draftsman. Went off to Vietnam. I wanted to be a combat artist. And I've pretty much stayed in it. When I was overseas, I was drawing people of the people of the Vietnamese, the military trucks. I did a series of paintings of men in my unit when we received orders to go overseas, wondering whether 1969, whether we were ever going to come back. And after I got out of the service, I started up my own sign company. I was a wood carver, sign maker.
So when did the sign company begin?
1971.
Yeah,
I got out of the service in 1970, and I ran the business for 44 years.
So what inspired you to, you were doing all of this artwork, and you said to yourself, okay, I'm going to start a sign company.
Oh.
What triggered that?
I was with who was now my wife, Mary Ellen. We've been married 50 years.
Congratulations.
And we were down the Cape, and I saw all of these carved wood signs, these nautical marine-themed signs. And I came home, and I actually found a little piece of wood. And I carved my initial into it. I made a little monogram for my sister Kenny, who had just gotten married, JMC. I made a sign for my mother for her birthday that said Honan. Someone asked me to make them one. So you wonder how you get, and I tell that to young kids today. I said, you're going to college for this, you don't know what you're going to do. You don't know what opportunity is going to come, somebody you're going to meet, an opportunity for an opening in a business, and the next thing you know, it has nothing to do with anything you went to school for.
And then you did the sign business in 44 years, and that continues on within the family.
Yeah, my nephew Matthew now runs the company.
But also, though, you then started building boats. Can you kind of elaborate on that?
Yeah, well, I was a woodworker, wood carver, and I've always been a boater, small boat sailor, been a member of the Cottage Park Yacht Club. My mother initially joined the Cottage Park Yacht Club, my mother and father, so that her five sons would learn how to sail. So 20 years ago, in 2002, I combined the two, my woodworking and my love of boating, and I built a small boat, and it was called Abuela El Sueño, which was grandmother's dream, because it was her dream that her sons would learn how to sail, and now her grandsons were learning how to sail and boats that they helped build. And right now I'm on boat number 14.
Wow, and, 14 boats.
You know.
So what do you do with the boats when you build them?
Some of them I keep. I have four now. I sell them, I give them away. I gave one to a youth rowing program down by the Barking Crab in Boston. My neighbor is always helping me, and he's got young kids. They said, Michael, take one of these kayaks, canoes that I built. If you and your three little children have half as much fun as my grandchildren, and I can watch it happen, I'll be happy. Last year, during COVID, something unusual happened, in that I had my grandchildren were in high school, and the schools were closed, and they came to work for me every day, boat building and doing my driftwood art. And my two granddaughters, Emily and Anna, one day saw me frustrated, and they asked me what was wrong, and I said, I can't figure this out, why I can't make these numbers add up on this boat I'm building, you know. And they said, well, maybe we can help you and figure it out. I said, no, you have to learn how to read a plan, read a scale ruler. It's too much to teach you. And they said, no, show us. And do you know, half an hour later, they were sitting there with the plan and the scale ruler and figured it out.
There you go.
And let me tell you, as terrible as COVID was, it was a silver lining in it, because my granddaughters and grandson would have never spent all day, you know.
I agree. That whole period, I know how hurtful and horrible it was, but it opened us up to so many other opportunities.
Yeah, yeah.
And kids actually, that's, you know, you call that real life learning.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
A lot of times they don't get that so much in school because they're just so used to that routine. But here, they had an opportunity that you were building something and they wanted to be part of it.
Yeah, and the boat went down to Mystic Seaport for the Wooden Boat Show run by Wooden Boat Magazine. And it got a second place, you know, and they were very much a part of it. My grandson, Benjamin, made the mast on it. And he said, how do we make it round? And I said, we just do it by hand. And it was a great experience. They may never build another boat, but they're always going to remember.
That's right.
Working with me and learning about me that I could never explain to them.
You know? So when you decide you're going to build a boat, do you bring in people who want to learn, or do you do
sometimes
it yourself? Or?
I had my neighbor's son, Christian Bonapane. He was coming home from school one day, and I said, hey, what's your name? And he said, Christian. And I said, you live across the street. I said, you want to learn how to build a boat? And he was like, why, who's building one? I said, I am. And he said, I don't know anything about building boats. I said, well, just follow instructions, come up. And he worked for me a couple of days a week. And we started right from the ground up, you know, building the frames and all the jigs and the molds that, you know. And he got to use every power tool there was, learned how to epoxy, fiberglass, fasteners, different types of adhesives. And so, like, I had my grandkids, my brother Stevie before he passed away.
So he learned from building that boat from the ground level.
I mean, yeah.
And the experience that he gained from that is experience he would have never gained from school.
Yeah.
And as you are well aware, a lot of shop classes now are no longer in public education because of, you know, technology and for what it is. So it's great on that.
Yeah.
I want to go over to another area of your work too that I see a lot of is your drift art.
Oh yeah.
Can you talk a little about that?
Well, about 7 years, 8 years ago, I've always been in the art field. And you know, like a lot of people in Winthrop, we walk the beach and we collect shells and beach glass and little unusual pieces of driftwood that are weathered and have a nice tone of texture. And so I was up in Gloucester and I saw these two 12-year-old boys and they had a piece of plywood like this and they were screwing down all these pieces of driftwood, making like a collage. And I said, wow. It lit a fire. And I said, wow. And so I've since carried it about 10 stages further. Just this past week I was down in Hull at the Lifesaving Museum. I had almost 40 adults and children doing a driftwood collage. 3 weeks ago, I was at Suffolk Law School in Beacon Hill doing a class for incoming freshmen. I have a doctorate in driftwood, known as Professor Driftwood.
So Professor Driftwood Honan.
Yeah, and so I mean,
all from two 12-year-olds.
Yeah, it inspired me, lit a fire under me.
I mean, I think that to me, that says something right there that, you know, you can learn from anyone. And you saw these, you know, two kids putting something together that inspired you to say, oh, this looks like something I could do.
Yeah.
I want to do it. And now you've made another career.
Yeah, I'm in several galleries up in Newburyport, Marblehead Art Association. Rocky Neck Art Association down the South Shore. I have two shows coming up in the next week or two. I do a lot of drawing. I'm in a drawing competition up in Essex on Sunday. It's an interesting one. It's plain art, plain air, where you're going to pick up the mood of the day, the fog or the sun. And so I'm going to join, I think, 30 or 40 other almost professional artists. And we have 2 hours. So you show up, you take your paint, your canvas or your paper, they stamp it, date it, and sign it. You sit down, you get your, you pick your place, that's what I'm going to paint over there, with the water down there and that boat on the beach. And they blow a horn, you have 2 hours.
You have 2 hours.
Yeah, you have 2 hours, called a quick draw. And at 10:30, they blow a horn, 30 minutes, 11 o'clock, stop.
Wow.
Now you have a half an hour to mat it, title it, frame it, and submit it to the judges. The first year I submitted, I was just honored to be amongst all these great artists. And so when the judging came, they called my name off, and I was like, oh! Because what happened was, I do oil pastels. So pastels are like chalk. Oil pastels are like crayons. It's like the two. So I usually set up an umbrella, because if it gets too hot, the pastels, oil pastels, will melt like a crayon. I was an hour into it, and the sun came out. I said, oh, I thought it was going to be overcast. Too far away, can't get my umbrella. I said, I'll just keep working. I'll do as best I can. And I submitted. I was happy to be here amongst everyone. And they called off my name and as a winner. And I went up and I said, this can't be. There's too much great art here today. And the judge says, Richard, you don't understand. There was tough judging here. But he said, Richard did something no one else did today. He did a true impressionist style with these dabs of color. So the moral to this story, and I tell this to young people, I say, when God gives you lemons, you make lemonade. I got a $250 cash prize, $100 worth of art materials and a gift certificate and materials. And so I'm going back up on Sunday to...
That's great. Yeah. That's wonderful.
And so I do that. I do my driftwood art. And I've actually had a piece in a museum.
So you talked a little bit earlier about that you're teaching it now, though. So how does that feel to teach?
Yeah.
Did you ever think that you would be a teacher or wanted to be a teacher? Or were you just...
No. You know, when I went off to art school, it wasn't even a college. So I didn't really go to college. It was more just an art school. I like to share what I do. So when I go and give a driftwood collage thing, I bring everything. The wood panel, the adhesive, the driftwood, the beach glass, the shells, everything. And so everybody's going to create something. And I enjoy sharing what I do. I like to inspire. I know, look at right here in Winthrop is Richard Gay, who's an Eagle Appliance. And he's appliance repair. And I got him doing it.
I just saw his photo. He
fish.
Did a, yeah, that. And I also saw him do a self-portrait.
I did the self-portrait.
Oh, you did.
So
it.
I do portraits, too. But he is now doing it. And if you go into Shoreside's coffee shop, on the front of the counter where you order is a big driftwood striped bass that Richard did. He never knew he had this inside him.
So you're bringing that out.
So he does it differently than I make collages, random items. He finds a piece of wood and he says, wow, this looks like the body of a bird. And I think if I put this piece with it, it's got the head, and I'll put some little feet that'll be something. And so he sees something that you don't or I don't. And he takes several pieces of wood and morphs them together. a couple of years ago with the Winthrop Art Association. I got him to enter, and he won.
Wow,
my God.
Great.
It was like he had been picked to have a piece in the Louvre in Paris.
So let's, I'm gonna switch gears, because I know that you do a lot of work. You're a Vietnam vet, and you do a lot of work for our veterans. And let's talk about your Christmas tree care package.
Okay.
So, because there's a lot of people out there that in Winthrop know what you do, but out in the further communities, I know I have benefited from it from my brother while he served overseas. And I think it's a wonderful program, and I'd like you to talk a little about that.
Okay. So 20 years ago, 2002, a young girl that grew up with my daughter, Kelly Nealand, went off to Afghanistan as an ROTC nurse. And so I asked my dad, what's she doing in the Army? Well, Dad, she was ROTC. She's a nurse, and she no sooner graduated, and they shipped her off. And so my daughter said, what are you going to do? I said, well, give me your name. I'm an address, and I'm going to send her something. What are you going to send her? I said, when I was in Vietnam, I said, as a 20-year-old, I wasn't afraid of being killed or shot. I mean, you get scared, but you're 20 years old. Not going to happen to me. I was afraid of being forgotten.
Ah.
And so I said, I'm going to write her, and I'm going to send her a package with some peanut butter crackers and fruit cocktail. And I used to get her shampoo and stuff. I'd go to Walmart's, CVS, and I'd send her a box every month. Well, I've been doing that 20 years, and I've sent almost 44,000. 22 tons of, many people have, in Winthrop have helped me. I mean, either donating goods or physically helping me. And about 7 or 8 years ago, I started with Christmas trees. I send them all around the world. If you said, who gets all these? I mean, is every one of them a Kelly? No, they are your nephew, your brother-in-law, your neighbor. They just have some roots to Winthrop.
In my case, it was my brother,
yeah,
who was, lives out in Seattle, but he was over in Afghanistan.
Yeah, and that was his roots. And so I started, I said, I'm going to send Christmas trees. And so last year I sent them to Sicily, Djibouti, Niger, South Korea, Japan, Okinawa is part of Japan, Persian Gulf. I send them to chaplains. And what is a Christmas tree care package? It's a box about this big, maybe 8 or 10 inches square. It's a 3-foot Christmas tree in it. Decorations, battery operated lights, garlands, ribbon candy. I have people that make cookies. And so the second week of November, I usually pack these boxes up with some elves. And why so early? They have to be shipped out by before Thanksgiving,
sure,
in order,
sure,
to get there so they can. And I've got great letters. And so if you said, well, do you need help? I don't need help. I have my Legion brothers at American Legion Post 146 help me in the assembly, and some of their family members. But I could always use letters from children,
okay,
drawings. He said, well, can I buy some goods for you to put in? Yeah, well, I'm planning on sending 50 of these, boxes of Cracker Jacks, peanut butter crackers.
So if people were interested in having one sent or being part of that, how do they get involved?
Yeah.
And maybe we can put that up on this program so that people can see that.
Yeah,
because I know it made a huge difference for my brother when that came to him. And as you said earlier, the part about being forgotten, you know, they don't want to be forgotten, and they're missing the holidays just as much. But he told me that, you know, all his colleagues were like, hey, where'd you get that? Who did that for you? Wow, you know, and that gave them that Christmas spirit that they needed.
Yeah, I put pictures of when I was in Vietnam, pay stub. I was making $34 a week, and and I like to think when you your nephew, your neighbor, or whatever gets this care package, that I put a smile on their face, a smile on their heart, and a smile on their stomach. And so they don't have to be from Winthrop. They don't have to even be from Massachusetts. You, John, will give us some information on where you can send me your information. Mm-hmm. I want the name of the soldier, his military address. Tell me a little bit about him, because I will write a letter to each and every one of them. I have written over 13,000 handwritten letters. I write and make sure every one of them gets a letter. And
let's just make people understand that. You personally write to each and every one of them, and you've written over 13,000 letters. That's great.
Yeah, and I just wanted to know a little bit about him. Maybe he's from Kansas. Maybe he likes mac and cheese. He likes Skittles. And I'll make sure those things go in the box. But like I say, so I need an address, a little bit of background about him. And what does this cost? It costs zero, doesn't it? Do I want a donation? Yeah, if you want to donate, but it doesn't cost anything. It's just the love of something I do. I'm very fortunate. I look at myself as one of the wealthiest people in this town, and not because I am financial, but I've been married 50 years. I got 2 daughters, 5 grandkids. I see them all the time. I build boats.
You just want to give back.
I'm in the American Legion. Yep. I'm the Housing Authority. I like to give back.
You're a good, supportive person.
Yeah, so if you know of somebody, and don't think that someone else is sending them something.
Right.
Because this box, they will share with everyone. Some places, a ship, they don't even have a Christmas tree. And or else if I send it to a chaplain, he takes it out in the countryside and shares it with men and women that are in some far-reaching outpost.
Well, I think that it's wonderful what you do. It means so much to many individuals. It also means a lot to us in the family who, you know, we miss our loved ones, and we're also, you know, we're back worrying about them. So thank you for doing that.
Yeah.
A couple other things I wanted to just, before we leave, I wanted to talk about your rowboat races and sailboat races.
Okay, so I do rowing, but not necessarily in the sunny summertime. I like to row.
I've seen that. Yeah. So let's go into that. It's not you're kind of like in the winter.
Yeah, in the winter when it's cold and icy and icebergs, and so I row in things like the snow row, which is down in Hull, and it takes place in late February, early March, and it's actually not a reflection of the weather. It's actually a reflection of our own Edward Rowe Snow, the historian and of Boston Harbor and the islands, and it's a tribute to him. And as a matter of fact, his daughter has been down there, and I've met her. And I do races. Let's see, I go down to Cohasset, and we go out around Minot's Light, you know, which is that black lighthouse. It's like Darth Vader. And then up to Essex, down the Essex River, and back up again. And then I row in the winter. I keep a boat at the Cottage Park Yacht Club. And so you say, what do you mean? You go out in January? And, well, a nice, bright, sunny day. Maybe, you know, it's high 20s, 30 degrees. You go out for a row. It's no different than going for a nice walk.
And how many people participate in it?
The one down in Hull, it could be 75 to 100 boats. Wow. Some of the boats have 6 people. Sometimes I row with my brother Billy, or my brother Stephen, who passed away, or my nephew Matthew. Sometimes I row by myself. Sometimes I take my dog, and he goes with me, even in the races. And it's a real effort. The sailing is more for fun. Sometimes people say, I see you sailing around Snake Island, but you don't go any place. And I say, well, it's kind of like walking around Deer Island. It's not the journey. It's it's the journey, it's just sailing. My brother Stevie had a saying, it's called We're There. And what it was is he would take people out of my boat and they'd say, Steve, where are we going? We're going to the Harbor Islands, we're gonna go up Boston Harbor. Where are we going? And he looked at him and said, what do you mean, where are we going? We're there.
We're there,
we're sailing. This is it.
So the enjoy the moment.
Yeah, it's enjoying the moment.
To get
you know,
somewhere.
You're out there sailing around. I don't have to go out in the middle of the harbor. Most of my boats are small. The last one I just built was only 12 feet long, very stable. There's watertight compartments in it. I'm looking more from my life is all about agility and stability today.
Well, I know that for me, and I would hope that our audience, I've learned quite a few things from you today. One is, no one is ever too old or too young to learn from anyone, as you talked about with the you know, being inspired by two 12-year-olds. And then just now about talking about living in that moment. It's not about where you have to go, but it's enjoying getting there.
We're there already.
Right, and so that is very appreciative. You know, a couple of final questions I have. I'm just curious, who were your role models while you were growing up? Or did you have any?
Yeah, my father was an auto mechanic. He had right across from what is now CVS, that was Bill Honan's Texaco station. Service with a smile.
Ah, okay.
I never really learned about automotive engines, but I learned a lot about the symptoms and what's wrong, and not what's wrong, but how to fix it. My grandfather, Anthony Bonzani, he taught me patience, because I would go over there and say, I'm making a go-kart. No, I need a saw. I'd cut this board, and he'd say, oh, no, we got to look. It's got a little curve to it. We got to straighten that out. And I'd be like, God, my buddies are outside. We just... So he taught me patience. And then people like John McCain, and I know some people don't like his political points and stuff, but I met him and shook hands with him, and I'll tell you, that was like meeting the President of the United States.
Absolutely,
you know?
He was an amazing
individual.
And
Dick Dimes, he was a real mentor to me.
Well, I want to thank you, Richard. This was wonderful today to kind of just talk to us about the things that you do. I know that you have a big birthday coming up, I believe.
No, not that big. 75.
75's pretty good. 75. And look at what you're doing at 75. I mean, all of these activities, all of this fun that you're having. And
I'm never going to slow down.
Stick around. We'll be right back with my next guest.
Okay, Dad. One, two, three. Ah! You saved me. Dad?
Are you okay?
I'm fine, dear.
Your hero needs you now, and AARP is here to help. Find the care guides you need at aarp.org/caregiving.
Welcome back. Our next musical guest is also a freshman in high school. She attends Austin Prep and has been performing since she was 3 years old, Miss Josie Barry. Hi, Josie.
Hi.
What are you going to sing for us today?
I'm going to be singing On My Own from Les Mis.
Wonderful. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Josie Barry.
On my own, pretending he's beside me. All alone, I'd walk with him till morning. Without him, I feel his arms around me. And when I lose my way, I close my eyes, and he has found me. In the rain, the pavement shines like silver. All the lights are missing in the river. In the darkness, the trees are full of starlight, and all I see is him and me forever and forever. And I know it's only in my mind.
myself and not to him. And although I know that he is blind, still I say there's a way for us. I love him, but when the night is over, he is gone. The river's just a river. Without him, the world around me changes. The trees are barren everywhere, the streets are full of strangers. I love him, but every day I'm learning. All my life, I've only been pretending. Without me, world will go on turning, a world that's full of happiness that I have never known. I love him, I love him, I love him, but
Thank you.
Welcome back. My next guest is a lieutenant in the Winthrop Police Department. He serves as a police peer support officer, a community outreach officer, and health and fitness officer. He is also the founding member of CLEAR, the Community and Law Enforcement Assisted Recovery Program. He was recently featured in the Netflix docuseries, How to Change Your Mind. Sarko, Gergerian, it's a pleasure to see you.
It's excellent to be here with you.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
I'll tell you, I have been amazed at the stuff that I've been watching that you've been doing. And, you know, it's so groundbreaking that I couldn't wait to get you here to talk to you about, you know, all of the innovative things that are going on. So, before, though, we get into that, I just wanted to ask you, can you tell us why you founded CLEAR and why you got involved in MAPS? But as you talk about MAPS, can you also, for the audience, tell us what MAPS stands for?
Sure, absolutely. Thanks, John. So let me start off with Community and Law Enforcement Assisted Recovery. I am a founding member of that in Winthrop. It started around 2014. And the idea came to me when I would come into the police department for my shift and review all the police logs and police incidents so that I would be caught up with the narrative of the community before I went out for my patrol shift. And what I would continually notice is that there was flaggable wording within the police log and the police incident that I could use as a reason to print the document out for follow-up into the community, right?
Okay.
So whenever people have a problem, they call 911. It could be for a well-being check. It could be because someone's struggling with depression or anxiety. It could be because there's family dynamics issues that are leading up to arguments that could possibly turn into domestic violence. The police department has all that information. We know where these challenges are. Traditional policing doesn't do anything with that information. Traditional policing creates cases for court. At the time, I was a patrol officer, lucky enough to be working under Terrence Delahanty, our chief, and he allowed me into his office, and I said to him, listen, can I make a pile of cases to follow up with on my patrol shift to see if I can connect with people on a heart level to get them to open up about their challenges and trust me and let me share their information with helpers? He thought I was gonna bang my head up against a wall. You know, patrol officer, bulletproof vest, radio gun, police car. It turns out if your heart and mindset are right, people open up to you. And I was getting so many people saying, yes, please connect me to appropriate help. We ended up having a good problem.
Right.
Where would we connect them? We connected them to the public health department. At the time, the director at the public health department had brought in people with lived experience into the organization, which was also one of the first public health departments to do that,
yes.
Right? And the handshake was made. Public safety, public health, working together. The team's grown, John. We not only have people with lived experience in the department sitting right next to my office, because I sit at the public health department now, but we also have a mental health professional, a licensed mental health professional supervised by BMC, Boston Medical Center. We also have resource navigators now so that people can get to the programs that will help them.
So you're working on not just, okay, you have this, you this is an issue, but you're trying to resolve that issue. So,
absolutely.
So it's kind of like the work we used to do with, you know, you keep asking why, and you keep going down and down and down till you get to the root cause.
Yep.
So it sounds like that's really what you're trying to find in order to really help someone.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because the other way wasn't working.
Well, the other way, exactly. You hear about this all the time. It's just a revolving door, right? And then you got to ask yourself, what's going on here? And fundamentally, I believe that one of the many goals of policing is keeping people out of cages and coffins.
Right.
So that's the driving force for me. And the police data is sitting in the police computer systems. We just have to choose to use it in a different way. And in Winthrop, we are.
You are doing that. I know that for
yeah.
sure. I've seen that firsthand. So but let's go back a little more. Why did you get involved? What is it about this that made you want to do this? You know, how did you get involved and why?
So let me ask you a question, John.
Sure.
With respect to CLEAR policing or MAPS?
Well, that's a good point. We're back to
yep.
MAPS. Can you explain to people what MAPS is?
Sure, sure. MAPS is the Multidisciplinary Association of Psychedelic Studies. It is an organization founded by Dr. Rick Doblin many years ago, and it came about when he realized that the federal government was going to move to schedule a substance, MDMA.
Okay. And would you explain what MDMA is?
Sure. MDMA is a empathogen. It's known as an empathogen. It's a psychedelic that's not exactly like your traditional psychedelics, you know, like the LSDs, mescaline, and all that. It does a very unique thing. It tempers down the amygdala in the brain. And when that happens, a person experiencing that doesn't get overwhelmed by their trauma. You see, it's a very specific and wonderful thing that it does.
And so what would be the purpose for MDMA?
Okay, so what MAPS has done is successfully show through clinical trials to the government that when paired with the psychotherapy, MDMA can assist in people resolving treatment-resistant severe PTSD, a pretty unresolvable challenge for some people.
Sure, sure, because, I mean, PTSD, when people are diagnosed with it, they think that that's it for, that's it. You know, they're going to have to suffer chronically forever on that.
Exactly.
And from what I've seen and watched in that is that they're trying to have some breakthroughs with this.
Yes, and I'm glad you used that word because the government has given MDMA and psilocybin breakthrough status.
Okay.
Because what they've realized is that these particular substances are so effective that they want to take barriers down for the research to come online. Imagine, both of which are Schedule I substances.
Wow.
Yeah.
And so you've seen it, and you've participated or seen it in firsthand with working with these folks who have had to do this?
Yes, yes. There's a little bit of a story connected to that. I would love to share it with you if you want
please.
To hear, right?
Yeah.
So, and everything's kind of interconnected, and the opportunities that arose were because of policing. You know, back when I went in to see the police chief about some of my thoughts for using the police data in this different way, he began to allow me to go to the International Association of Chiefs of Police conference. And I'd say about 3 or 4 years back, it happened to be in Florida. And both the chief and I were going to go. The reason that he began taking me is because he wanted me to go and study the police psychology track of courses and come back and debrief and see what ideas we have and what we can use to make what we're doing better. Right? Isn't that what a conference
what
is supposed to
right,
be
for? Right, right, exactly.
So this one particular conference, again, I'm completely excited. Obviously, I get to go to this conference with the chief. He had to pull out of going that 1 year. So I got really bummed out. I was like, well, if he's not going to go, I'm obviously not going to go, right? But I said, I should just ask, you know, why assume? So I went into his office and I said, hey, am I going to go to this if you're not going? He said, absolutely. Keep doing what you're doing. I mean, we need you to go down there, take all the courses you're interested in, bring them back. Let's see what we got and what we can do, right? So that year I went down and they had invited Rick Doblin down to present phase 2 clinical trials results for MDMA-assisted psychotherapy. Now, I saw this on the flyer and I was like, what is going on here? You know, at this particular conference, this MDMA is a Schedule I substance,
right?
So the day that he was going to present, I distinctly remember this. I was on the second floor of the conference hall and they had just told the people at the convention, at the conference, that Donald Trump was going to be there to speak. And they plugged him in exactly at the time when Dr. Rick Doblin was going to speak. So if I went to the right, I would have been able to see our president at the time speak to all the police chiefs and upper admin level people who go to this conference. And to the left was Rick. Luckily, I picked left. So I went, and he was set up with people from MAPS, people with lived experience, a retired vet, people who used to work for the feds, retired from the feds. They were all on stage, like a panel with a big screen in this nice auditorium style room, but there was like 15 or 20 of us in there.
Sure.
Just because of the way it went
right.
down.
Right, the conflict.
Exactly. So I sit in the front row like I usually do for all this stuff, and before he was even done presenting, I'm trembling with excitement. And I'll tell you what got me. 67 to 70% of the people in phase 2 trials no longer could qualify for the diagnostic label, PTSD.
Really?
After they went through the protocol with the medicine paired with psychotherapy. I was like, what is going on? You know, I got so excited. All I could think about is I need help. I need help. So I jumped on stage, beelined right up to Rick, and put my hand out and said, hi, my name's Sarko. How am I helping with this? And he shook my hand, and he asked me some questions. And he found out I was a working officer and a working psychotherapist. And he said, you know, the best way to help with this, Sarko, is become a psychedelic-assisted psychotherapist. And he gave me his card. So that's how this all came about, because he was a man of his word. When I emailed him, he got back in touch with me. I got pulled into the first training cohort. And it turns out that the federal government had given permission for healthy normals to experience the medicine in a research protocol. And they got me into that.
That must have been an experience.
Oh, it was. It really was.
I mean, I know that if you watch the docuseries, they talk to you, that you talk about what it is, and I know what you said there, but I'd like you to express it because one of the questions was asked, well, why would you want to do that? Why did you decide to follow and go through that program?
Got you. Well, I agree with the therapist experiencing the medicine that the client's going to be on. So that was the driving impetus. And when I found out that the feds had agreed with that as well, I found it to be extremely fascinating, which led me, obviously, to come back to Winthrop and go right over to my boss, mm-hmm. the chief, and say, listen, this opportunity kind of has come online. And he knows what drives me, finding people and helping them.
Right.
But that includes our first responders. So endgame vision, me sitting and holding space for somebody on these medicines, for psychotherapy that can be 8 hours long in one day, right?
Yeah.
I mean, are we in the business of trying to help people, right? Stay out of cages, stay out of coffins? Then this needs to be looked at. And I want to make sure that first responders, that our police aren't 2-3 years behind what's going on and available for our civilians. Because there's a tragedy at play with first responders. I don't know if you know these numbers.
No.
But more officers die by suicide every year than do by getting attacked by others.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And here's another one for you. On average, officers pass away 5 to 10 years after retirement. That means that we're dying a full 20 years before civilians. What does that say? We've got a problem.
Yeah. So how do you get to the root cause of that through this?
Right? So I think we need to destigmatize access for our first responders, all of them, including our vets, including active military. If you have a problem, you should be able to go get help with that problem without any fear of backlash, you know? And there's so much stigma around this particular set of medicines. And that word psychedelic comes out, people like shut down and they get nervous. And there's been years of misinformation, years of bad research around, you know, concerns about how dangerous these things are.
Well, and then there was so much stigma against, you know, when people would get into drugs, mm-hmm. and they would have a problem. And a lot of the times they would get into a drug. Not, and it wasn't because by choice, they might have taken something, and then because it was laced with something, now they have no choice, and they would get into that, and there'd be that stigma and all of that. And I think, I remember from being here in the community and working with you, Winthrop has done a wonderful job of trying to take that stigma away,
yeah,
and really help people. But I think that's a lot of credit to the work that you've done, because you've come in and you have said, no, we need to help them. This is going to help us, too, by helping them.
There it is.
And so I think that, to me, says a lot. And now if you're looking to move into this type of, you know, future of really helping people that are have PTSD and there's a solution out there, then why aren't we exploring it?
Right.
We need to explore it. And for so long we've looked at things where it's, oh, no, you can't do it that way. No, it has to be this way.
Yeah.
And I was very excited to see that. I was proud. I was really proud to watch that and to know that I've worked alongside of you, alongside of the chief, and to see that we're trying to do work with this breakthrough stuff that's going to help people,
mm-hmm.
that may actually resolve and solve these problems.
Right.
So I really appreciate that work that you're doing. You know, if a person would like to get into this field,
mm-hmm.
of study, what are the requirements of becoming a psychedelic assisted psychotherapist?
Oh, right on. Yeah. So right now, MAPS is trying to train somewhere between 30, 40, 50,000 therapists.
Wow.
In preparation for when the feds give the go, right?
Okay.
Everything's contingent upon that. These modalities are not legal and available yet. They're still in research stages. Of course, very far along. Phase 3 clinical trials now, the results are showing a lot of promise. So everyone's saying this is going to be a modality that's available within a year or two. Okay? Therapists need to be at a master's level or higher education level. And that's how they can get involved. They could go to the MAPS website, right? And they can.
And we'll put that up on the. We'll get that information. We'll have that on the screen for people if they're interested in that.
And then they can also look up expanded access sites, right? Mm-hmm. These are clinics that are working with modalities that are currently legal, like ketamine, in preparation for the other psychedelics to come online, right? Mm-hmm. To be legal and to be told what it is okay to be used for by the federal government, by the Food and Drug Administration and all of that.
Great. That's wonderful. Now, the other question I wanted to talk about was, from your training as well as the experience, what did you think is important for people to know about, you know, psychedelic-assisted psychotherapy?
Oh, this is a great question. I think the big thing that I want to share with you and the audience, John, is that there's hope. There's hope. They are doing things with these substances paired with psychotherapy, being very conscious of set and setting, mindset and setting, right? That is going to flip psychiatry on its head. You know, let me try to give an example of that. Imagine coming in to do psychotherapy with somebody, and instead of it ending in 45 minutes or 50 minutes, you know, clocks up, see you next week.
Right.
You're there for 8-9 hours. And trust me, you're not getting bored. You're going in. Can you imagine?
It's like if you were going for brain surgery, right? They don't stop in an hour or two. They don't stop until they've solved the problem.
Yep.
They fix it. So whenever you go in for surgery, they go, and if it takes 13 hours, 15 hours, they do it.
That's right.
That's what this sounds like.
Yes.
They're going to go in, and they're going to try to solve the problem.
And get to it. Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. Right? So the protocol has you, of course, spaced out appropriately. You come in for a session, that can be 8 hours long. And then you're going to process that afterwards, off the medicine. And then you're going to come in for another session. Right, three of those equals, I mean, we'd have to do the math, a year worth of therapy, you know?
Right.
With your amygdala tempered down, so you don't feel like you're becoming overwhelmed by the situation, and you can go there and talk about it and feel what you need to feel.
And you're using it. It's not like they're giving you this and you're doing it on your own. You're using it and you're talking about it with someone, and you're being a part of it so that they're working through that.
Yep.
And one of the things that I saw on there was that there, and I think you've said it too as well, you know, you have that feel for love. There's a feel of love, and so therefore you're able to express yourself differently and think differently. Is that, am I correct on that?
Absolutely. I'm glad you brought that up, because I said it on the you saw it happening live, but I've talked about it after the fact as well. Imagine the first thing that I felt. And of course, this is going to be different for different people. But the first thing I felt was love. And the whole space that I was in with these two amazing human beings, therapists, Michael and Annie Mithoffer, was the safety of the container, this love, you know? And then the next thing that immediately came up was a feeling and then a thought about gratitude. And this Rolodex of experiences and people and family and work and friends, and it kept flipping and flipping, and I could see them and think about them, and I wanted to talk about them. But the same Rolodex also started to go into challenging things, issues. But it was on the same Rolodex. So it caused a little bit of tension that I had to process and make sense of. Well, there is always an underbelly to the good,
right?
And if I'm grateful for being in this country, I have to reevaluate all the things that went into how I ended up in this country, right?
Right.
So it was a really remarkable experience, and I feel like I was allowed to tap into something sacred and special and safe.
Wow. So How do you think this is going to change psychotherapy? I know we kind of touched on it a little earlier, but what do you, I mean, it's really going to open the doors wide.
It really is. Yeah, and the whole paradigm is going to have to shift. Insurance modalities are going to have to shift. You know what it's going to do, John, is it's we're going to be able to move away from what I call Band-Aid medications.
Right?
Yeah. That just basically give you a superficial aid to help with symptoms into opportunities to go into the core of the onion, right? Peel the layers back and sit with it.
Right, but it's going to help people. And I think that that's really what's so important is that people are suffering.
Yep.
And for reasons, you know, they have their reasons for why they're suffering, but let's, as you said earlier, let's peel that onion away and let's try to help them so that they have those coping skills, they've gone through it, and now they feel like I can keep going on. That was one of the very positive things that I got out of episode 3. I want to make sure everybody knows that.
Yes, yeah.
On the how to change your mind.
Yeah.
But was the relief that they were able to feel of maybe I can move forward now.
There it is.
And that's a gift. And so if you can give that gift to somebody and you can help somebody obtain that moving forward, then I'm all for it. And I applaud you and the people that want to participate and do this, because I think that that's what needs to help for our community. So I want to thank you today for coming in and talking about all of these groundbreaking things that are happening, and also just share that, you know, I'm really proud of the work that you are doing, proud of our chief and the work that he's doing with the community, because, you know, he could have said no, he could have stopped that, and yet he has a vision as well of opening up this, because I've known our chief for many years and working alongside him, and I've never met a more caring individual who wants people to succeed and be helped. And I really appreciate that, of hearing that he's opening those doors as well.
Well, you just brought something up. I just want to say caring and courageous, right? Mm-hmm. And he's the first to go, well, you think that would work? Let's see what that means, right? Like, you know, our people and our officers need this. They need access to more things that allow for hope, so that when we get to retirement, we can enjoy that second half of life,
right,
rather than be torn apart by our demons, you know?
Right, and there's so much, you know, for the police and this and there, you know, people are all of that stuff that's going on, and really what we need to do is help them, because they're going through so much trauma on a day in and day out basis. People don't realize that who don't work in that industry, what you see.
That's right.
That you protect us from not seeing.
That's right.
And so we have to help you order to make sure that you're okay with it too. So,
yeah, you keep triggering a thought in me. I want to share one other point.
Please do.
You know, the many people in the public don't understand that over the course of a career in law enforcement, the amount of critical incidents the average officer ends up seeing or helping with is somewhere around 200 on average. 200. Most people end up with just 4 or 5 in a lifetime, right? So you reach retirement, you know, which is looping back to where we started, with this gigantic backpack of traumas in it that you've helped with. Some have been successful, some haven't been successful. Some we save the person, some we don't save the person. And you got to process that out. Our people need access. Our people need to be able to take that backpack off and put down and look at what's in it so that they can have a retirement instead of.
Yeah, so they can move on.
Yeah.
Thank you for watching In the Limelight. Special thanks to our in-house music director, Sarah Byrne Martelli, our guests, and to WCAT. See you next time.